Doing it again.
Yeah. All right. Hi, everybody. It's MP, and I'm joined once again by the lovely Claire Gray, who is the winner of the Win Your Very Own MP contest that we had on my channel sometime.
About a year ago. Yeah. Cool. Cheers.
I know there was thousands and thousands of entries, but Claire was the winner. Cheers.
I won my own mice to pain.
Her very own MP, what she's going to do with it, I have no idea, but she's got me for at least 6 months. So this is our episode 9, Dance with Dragons review and analysis. You usually give us the start here, so I'm going to let you go.
Well, just to say that we did... We did try to record reviews for episode 7 and 8 together.
They exist.
It proved too complicated trying to do it together. Plus, we were drinking whiskey. So I would say that there's probably about 3 hours of bloopers rather than content. But if anyone's interested in listening to it, because we did say some quite interesting things, I think.
There was a lot of stuff that we did on that was probably pretty good. I don't think was heard elsewhere. And there was a lot of stuff that didn't pan out the way, at least, I predicted. So that might just end up on the chopping block. But
I don't know. Let us know if you want to see any of that anyway. We're trying
we'll
to
definitely have
it
a
down.
Blooper reel,
yeah,
for sure.
We'll probably put it out in a couple of episodes. But yeah. So yeah, as per usual, if you're not up to date with the books and the TV show, proceed with caution. We're going to be giving our own observations, speculations based on book reading experience. Okay. Oh, God. I really struggled, actually, with... I don't know how many links to give this episode, in all honesty.
I like it. I know it was a hard episode for many people to watch, myself included. I'm sure there was a lot of... clenched teeth and everything watching it. But that said, for the simple fact that it's a lot of it was stuff that you don't know what's coming and it's everything's new to you, it's a 4 in my books. I was thinking it would actually be a 5. I was hoping for a 5, and I expected at least the attempt on Shireen. I didn't think that she was actually going to burn, which was a very hard scene to watch. But regardless of any of that, I'm still giving this episode a 4. Out of 5.
In all honesty, I've been deflated for like the last 2 days.
You have.
I think I've just found it really difficult to kind of wrap my head around it. I think I don't think I ever really thought about Shireen being burned, but if I'd have ever had that notion in my head, I would never have thought it would have been Stannis.
Have you not been having conversations with me all this season?
Yeah, but not about that. Not about that possibility happening.
Burn.
Not Stannis. Burning Shireen.
Oh, okay. Stannis burning Shireen.
Yeah,
no, but we had discussed that Shireen would be sacrificed, or at least the attempt of the sacrifice.
The sacrificial lamb.
My feeling would have been that Davos was going to save her. Obviously, Stannis circumvented that by sending him away, which kind of
I just don't understand it from a... I don't know. I think I'm going to find this review quite difficult because of it. I found it difficult to watch the rest of the episode, and I think it was only when Jorah threw the spear in the fighting pit that I suddenly perked up a bit and thought, right, okay, let me just see what this last bit is about. Okay, yeah.
I can see that. I can see how that would be a moment where you kind of snap back into reality and like, oh, sure, they're fighting. Oh, shit. You got the harpies everywhere.
I just found it difficult, and I tried to look at this from different angles, and I've tried to think about, to be honest with you, what it boils down to for me is the only thing that I'm really concerned about. I don't give a shit about how they portray things and how they interpret things in the TV show. And sometimes I really like what they've done. They've managed to kind of appease book readers. They've got a big job to do with this TV show, and I'm not knocking them for that whatsoever. I just think some of the decisions they make, I don't know where they came from. And it really worried me when I heard that they said, you know, in the inside episode that, oh, well, you know, George told us that this would happen.
Yeah.
Well, that's it, that this happens. And they didn't specify George told us that Stannis does this, just that this happens to Shireen.
Correct.
And I think for me, it just kind of boils down to, from a book perspective, I don't think this could possibly happen, just given the
geography.
Logistics and the geography and just where everybody is at the moment. Stannis is not at the wall. He's at a crofter's village just outside of Winterfell. He's not with Mel or Selyse or Shireen. They're all at the fucking wall. Yeah.
And they're at the Nightfort.
Yes.
Correct? Or yes. They're not at Castle Black.
No. They're at the Nightfort.
They're also leagues away from Castle Black.
Yeah.
But we don't know what happens in the books, whether or not there's a defeat of Stannis and he retreats back to the wall and he's going to need to sacrifice Shireen there.
What makes sense to me in the books is if Shireen is going to get sacrificed or burned alive. Oh, God. It just really...
She's not really real, just so you know.
Yeah, just the screams and the... She's just such a sweet girl, and the actress who plays her was brilliant. Oh, God, yeah, I just find it really difficult to even think about or talk about. I'm trying to put a kind of intellectual perspective on this, and I'm trying to bring it back to where I feel comfortable in terms of the books. Stannis isn't anywhere near Shireen in the books. And we know that he sends his man off to Braavos, and he says, if you hear that I'm dead, it might even be true.
Put Shireen on the throne.
Put my daughter on the throne. And there's never any question that there's got... Yes, he's... You know what? There's king slaying all over the place in this
king
series.
Kin slaying everywhere.
We've got evil little shits like Joffrey as child characters.
Mm-hmm.
You know, nothing's really that much of a shock, really, when you think about it, in the grand scheme of things. But I just don't believe that Stannis would be responsible for this in the books. I think if it happens, it happens at the wall. And I agree with what a lot of people have said already, which is...
Finish.
This will be a device that's used by Mel to resurrect Jon. You know, and if you think about it in terms of blood, magic and sacrifice... And if you think about what Miri Mazda said at the beginning, only death can pay
and
for life.
To that note, and we're kind of jumping ahead still here. We dove right into it, which is fine, but there are other things that we should touch on a little bit before we get into Stannis and the Wall. But having you just said that, this is also possibly a way that we see through the show that Stannis is not ever going to become Azor Ahai, or conversely, that he will be.
No, I don't think he is. I think Mel has seen in her flames, in her point of view chapter in the books, she's kind of ditching Stannis and she's pinning all her hopes now on Jon as being. She's seen Snow and Jon Snow in the flames.
Yeah.
She's diverting her attention from Stannis to Jon. I don't think she really gives a shit really about Stannis anymore. She thinks Jon is Azor Ahai. That's where I think it's going to be going in the books. And I think that given what's happened to Jon, she will convince everybody that the only way to bring him back is to only death can take
for
life.
Who's everybody? People at the wall, will Stannis have joined them? Or is she just
going to
convince...
I don't even know who's in Jon's corner anymore.
Exactly.
In the books.
She can send for Selyse
and
Shireen.
God, this is driving me crazy. I don't know what to think anymore. Oh.
Welcome to the club. Anyways.
But the point I'm trying to make is the showrunners, Dan and Dave, whatever the bloody call, but Dan and Dave, and, you know, fair enough, they've done a decent job of such a big epic story and televising it. But when they said this happens in the books and that George told them that this happens in the books, that is that I think needs to be interpreted differently to George sat down and told us that Stannis burns Shireen in the books, because if that happens in the books and that's how it plays out in the books, that's not how Stannis' character has been developed. And when we go into this in a bit more detail, you will see my take on things and my spin on things, and maybe I'm desperately trying to look around for excuses of how this has happened. The show was a shock, and when it comes to what kind of impact did it have on you? I'm still pissed off 2 days later. 2 days later, it's a TV show. Crazy. But that's the effect it's had. So if that's how it was meant to come across, then well done. It's worked on me. It's worked on me.
No pun intended, well done, by the way. Too soon?
Oh, fuck off. Yes. Really, really too soon. You're horrible.
I said it to Charlie too in a tweet.
Oh, God.
The other thing is, I have my Brit card. My tooth has fallen out, or at least a cap on my tooth. So if you see a gap, that's what's happening.
Seriously? I'm kidding.
We make fun of your teeth all the time.
No, it's just how you jumped from me being upset about something to, oh, by the way.
I just realized that I hadn't mentioned that my cap's fallen on. I'm probably okay. Grinning. I have bad teeth to begin with anyways. But...
are we ready? Sorry, I'm going to go on a rant with this, so you better be prepared for it. Okay, let's just cover it. Let's get it out of the way with first.
Anyways, your rating was what?
I've gone from, in my head over the last 2 days, I've gone from fuck your links.
She was like a five.
Fuck your links. To five the last 5 minutes where Danny gets on the dragon and it's all like, oh my God, this actually seeing this rather than reading it had quite a big effect on me. And I'm not a huge Danny fan, to be honest with you. But I was tearing up a little bit when she was like, flying off on Drogon at the end, especially because he was injured and he was kind of crawling on his wings to get up into the sky, and it was like, oh, so that was that had
and this is quite the weird thing
so
about...
I said five at the time, but I keep going backwards and forwards. Let's just say three as an average then, if you're pushing me for links.
But she did give it a five at one point. The Dany scene with Drogon, and we're still digressing from even starting this, but that Drogon getting speared, and I guess the visualization of a mythical dragon getting tortured, I think affected me personally more than the Shireen burning, which is a horrible thing to say. And I know everybody's talking about it. It's Shireen and the screams and everything, and it was tough to watch, but it wasn't super tough to watch. It was just like, let's let this be over with. Whereas Dany, we know that eventually she's going to get on Drogon and go, but we're just seeing Drogon like taking these spears, and I wish they would have ended the Shireen scene a lot quicker rather than having her just make it stop, which is the same thing I had. Like, let's just get to the end where Dany gets flown away instead of having to witness, at least with Shireen, we just hear it. Drogon, you actually get to see it. I think that's probably my point. But I was a little bit more affected by Drogon, and I don't know why
it's
that
just
is.
Put like a real shitty filter on the rest of, well, certainly the rest of that particular episode. When it finished, and you can hear the screams and everything, and it goes to Meereen, and they're in the big grand arena for the grand games, whatever that is. I mean, clearly it wasn't the wedding. This happens in the books at the wedding of Danny and Hisdale. And I was like my eyes were on this box, but it just wasn't going in for like the first 5 minutes. I don't know if they would have deliberately. It was just like crowd shots and kind of dialogue in the box. And maybe they did that deliberately, knowing that it would take people a while to recover from the previous scene. But in all honesty, after that had happened with Shireen, I was in such complete fucking disbelief that whatever was going on in the first few minutes in
Both of us, when we watched it the second time, we figured that the Shireen burning was within 20 minutes of the episode. Yeah, we didn't realize it was right before the Danny scene. Like, neither of us did. We're like looking for it. Where is it? Where is it? And that's the first scene
before the last scene. The Shireen sacrifice is the penultimate scene in the entire episode. Whereas I thought it was right. I thought it was because we were watching Kraken's reaction video, and I was saying it'll be in the first 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
It's right at the beginning. It was like, oh, actually no. And it was only when we rewatched it.
Mm-hmm.
It was, and I remember when we watched it together, obviously this week. And at the end of the episode, I said to you, "Is that it? That seemed to be." The whole episode seemed to have finished in about 20 minutes.
We're just so invested and like flabbergasted that it just zoomed by, which I hate. I hate when that happens.
Right, let me try and be sensible now then. Okay.
Theme. You don't have one?
No, you had a good theme, I think, this time.
Okay, I got a few good themes, I think. I just have to find them. Okay, so obviously a theme for A Dance with Dragons is sacrifice. I also have comparable themes with fight or flight. What your options are when you're stuck between a rock and a hard place, and this is something that plays out through all the episodes, or pretty much every scenario that we have through this with. The Night's Watch and the Wildlings, Doran and Trystane, these are the sacrifices. Alaria sacrificing her vengeance and kneeling. Arya arguably sacrifices her mission to follow Trant.
Mm-hmm.
Jorah sacrifices himself to get into the arena. And the gladiators themselves are sacrificing themselves. Danny sacrifices her judgment of Jorah and actually gives him her hand at the end. Danny sacrificing everybody and just taken off at the very end.
She leaves everybody behind.
She has no idea what's going to happen after she's gone. Yeah. She doesn't come back to try to save them. She's gone. And last but not least, the show sacrificing Stannis' character. And this, I think, is an interesting point. And I have written here, and I'll mention it later, but this is a quote from Doran to Alaria, and it is, "Your rebellion is over now. You can swear your allegiance to me or die." I think this is what's going through Stannis' head. This is his choice at this moment. Now, he's deciding, does he want to be king? Or does he want to become Azor Ahai? That's what this sacrifice is.
So swear your allegiance to the prophecy.
Swear your allegiance to R'hllor. Or die where you're standing right there, because there's no way out for you. This is what I mean by the theme of you're stuck between a rock and a hard place.
I don't care. The whole thing stinks like a big steaming turd to me. But
fair enough.
That was an interesting interpretation, though.
It is.
Okay. But can we just get this Stannis stuff scene out of the way so that I can cheer up a bit?
Okay.
I'll try anyway. Okay. Right. So we get Mel. I've always fucking hated that bitch, you know. I really do. I hope in the books, I think I've mentioned this in several comments, but I hope in the books that Val ice magics the shit out of Mel at the wall, and that's what brings the wall down. That's my fantasy of what happens. I've never. She might be doing this with like not realizing that what she's doing, it's for the greater good and blah 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 and what have you. And she's got her. Maybe she is. I think the actress said sometimes people do think, like Sam said, people do the wrong things for the right reason. Whatever Sam, the justification that is, I fucking hate her and I always am.
Same quote Stannis gives to Shireen just before as well. Different variation of it.
I'm going to find this really difficult to be sensible about this. But anyway, Mel comes out of the tent and she sees the fires that have been set around the camp. So that's Ramsay and his 20 good men. Well, they must be fucking good to get past a seasoned military strategist like Stannis and burn.
Well, Stannis didn't have it. He just had guards. That's not
okay. But even so, you know, I think artistic license for TV. Then you have, I don't know. I mean, I was thinking of all sorts of things here about the fire, about, you know, just Mel seeing the fire, and it's like, there's your symbol of the Red God, of R'hllor. There are the fires, but they don't seem to be doing you any good now, do they? But anyway, then we have a scene with Davos and Stannis, where Stannis sends him on a fool's errand back to the wall. He does say something that made me sort of stop and think was Stannis said to Davos, ride for Castle Black and don't come back empty-handed. And it just made me think, I wonder what Davos will actually come back with. So if he say, if the last thing you heard was
that's interesting right there.
Yeah.
And we've actually talked about this, but you haven't thrown that quote in there, empty-handed. And look, Davos is Stannis's hand. Don't come back empty-handed. So does that mean when Davos comes back, he's, fuck that, you're done to me. You just killed your fucking daughter.
I'm empty-handed.
You don't have a hand anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's kind of cool.
Or does he come back with something unexpected that isn't? I mean, he won't have known. He won't know until he gets back to the camp what's happened to Shireen. So the only way
he can find out is if somebody somehow, for some reason, sends a raven to the wall and says what happens. Like, realistically, right now, if we see Davos at all, next episode, he's going to be arriving at the wall, talking to Jon. I don't think we're even going to get to see him.
That'll be it, I think, for arrive this season. Back, yeah. I don't think there'll be any of that.
Unless something happened, his horse threw a leg and he has to fucking crawl back to camp and he somehow...
Then we get a scene with Davos and Shireen. God. Where he gives her the stag that he's made, which is beautiful, I thought.
Yeah.
I like handmade things. And she said, will you make me a doe too so he can have some company? That made me really sad, even without knowing what was going to be happening next, because I just thought she's been such a lonely child. You know, and she's a lone stag, and can she have some company?
Her best friend.
Yeah.
And then she did have, of course, Sam and Gilly there at the wall. But
in the books, she does have a little bit of company. She's got Edric for a while, she's also, we don't have Patchface in the TV show, but she's got...
And he's with her at the wall.
Patchface is creepy as fuck. He's with her at the wall, and he's freaking everybody out at the wall, because he's just so cryptic and weird, but there seems to be a connection between Patchface and Shireen that's really genuine and you know, she's at the very least she has him for company. And I just thought that was really sad when she said, can you make me a doe too so you can have company?
There is. And
but you've got more
so
from
many,
that.
No, but there's so much that we could argue with and pull from, and I don't actually have the conversation that she had with Stannis down, and all we have with what is her quote with about the doe to Davos?
Will you make me a doe too so he can have company?
Will you make me a doe too so that he can have company?
Mm.
you can look at this in the simple, plain way that she wants her a doe for her stag, just to for what it is. Or you can take it to another level of, will you make me a doe too? Will you make me a doe also so that he can have company? Will you make me a doe? Aside from being a female deer, it's also a form of a name for a goat, which is something that can be sacrificed. And earlier I had said she's going to be the sacrificial lamb. I don't think doe applies to lamb. That's a kid, right? Or, no, a lamb's a lamb. Yeah, a lamb is a lamb. Sheep, yeah.
But there have been these references to the sacrificial lamb.
If you're leaving me, will you make me a sacrifice too?
Mm-hmm.
Are you going to let me stay here and not take me away so that he can have company? Now, who's he in my head at this point? And I'm not saying that this is what's meant. I'm just saying this is what I'm thinking about is R'hllor, so that he can have company. She's, and this is before even she talks to Stannis, I believe, but sort of this weird conversations you place them wherever you want to, at least I do.
Just to add to that, there was a comment that I saw actually from Barbara. Hi, Barbara. Barbara Revel.
Yes, and we did answer your questions in the aforementioned video reviews that we did, that we haven't put out yet. It is about 3 hours. We got about 2 hours actually uploaded to YouTube, but there's technical difficulties with them. And the third part, we still have to. That's not the technical difficulty. We've already edited most of that stuff out. And it's her, by the way.
Let's get, we'll think about the bloopers. But anyway, Barbara had made a comment on somebody's channel. I think it might have been Tony's Rant channel Tony's Rant video on Rant video on Stannis. And she was talking about the symbolism of this is the end of the Baratheon line, because she was carrying the stag to the with her when she was burned. So the stag was burned. That's a kind of, you know, that means that the Baratheon line has ended, which I thought was brilliant. I thought it was a really great comment, Barbara. And I think to add to that, I would say, to me, stag and doe is king and queen. So when she's asking, will you make me a doe so he can have company? That's as if she's saying, can the king have a queen? And when she takes the stag with her to be burned, there is never going to be a queen, Shireen, of House Baratheon. Oh, God, it's just so sad.
I don't know why. I disagree with that wholeheartedly. And I believe I've had discussions with even Tony about this way, way back in the early, early days of anybody doing stuff when he was first around, and I was just a person in the comments, that
she would have made a great queen.
I've always found it odd that I'm not a big Stannis fan myself, and I found it odd that Tony chose Stannis as his champion and everything like that. But the one comment that I made to him, which is because he's Tony, and I, well, maybe that's interesting. Do you think, are you picking Stannis for your champion because of Shireen, who has the grayscale, and are you thinking of the stone dragon, wake the dragon from stone?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sold that we've seen the last of Shireen. We have to have. We've had it with Dany beforehand. Another sort of phoenix rising from the ashes again. Now that could be Jon, could be Shireen. Stannis is at his lowest point now. Does he somehow get redeemed and rise up and become somebody new? I just wouldn't count Shireen as gone yet. I don't know what's going to happen with her. I don't have any sort of predictions. But she does have grayscale. That has to mean something, somehow. Why do we have Shireen with grayscale and it's never going to come into play anywhere
there's
in this story?
There's surely more to be delved into with that. There's got to be with the battle with the others.
Even when we start talking about Val and Shireen and keep her away from me. So maybe Shireen gets burned because of Grayscale. I don't know.
I said to you when we were watching it, I don't know if I was just imagining this, but when we first see Shireen in the TV series, it looks as though the Grayscale is just kind of on a cheek here. And in this episode, it looks as though it's right across, like the top of a temple, right down to a chin. It looked like there was more of it to me, and it was a bit, and it's supposed to be dormant.
In Shireen, it's supposed to be dormant, and my response was, I'm not sure, I can't remember what it originally showed up as, but...
I don't know, let us know what you think. Do you think...
Well, we can go back and check, but yes, please let us know.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, so have you done your...
Well, then we get the scene with Stannis and Shireen.
Okay.
She's talking about, he asks her what she's reading again, and she talks about the stories from the Dance with Dragons, the original Dance with Dragons. And Stannis doesn't seem to be that aware of the story or the legend, because he says to her, oh, it's just two quotes here where he says, that doesn't make much sense. And that's exactly how I felt at the end of that scene.
Explain.
That doesn't make much sense. What he did doesn't make much sense.
Oh, yes. And this was a great point. You told me this before. I like this.
So in the tent, he says to her, well, that doesn't make much sense, when she's talking about the Dance with Dragons. And she said, I think it's poetic. Oh, God, just thinking about it makes me want to cry.
Powerful words right there. You're saying... what Stannis did doesn't make much sense, but Shireen's own words are, I think it's poetic.
Yeah.
And then you apply that to the burning. Is it poetic, I guess?
And then he says, forgive me.
Yes.
And she doesn't even know what it's about.
And so far, nobody is forgiving Stannis.
No.
I might be the one person who might, well, I think there's a few others. But...
get out. I'm kidding.
6 months. That's the deal. You won me.
I kept the receipt. Okay. Oh. I can't even talk about this next scene.
I'm trying to think of your Tyrion joke. Did that air, or is that in
the
last video?
That was something that I said I was going to say, but we didn't. I didn't in the end.
Okay.
About the...
well, you said it. We recorded it. I just don't know if it... okay, so it's in our other...
it's the one that we did, yeah, but we probably never air. I don't even think I can talk about the scene. You saw it. I don't want to relive it again.
What about Selyse? You had said before, actually, didn't you say it in our...
maybe she comes to her senses last minute, and it looks like she did.
And you said that in our episode 7 and 8 review, right? You
said that you thought... I think I've said it somewhere, yeah.
You heard some people had said that Selyse would have a spell lifted off of her.
Yeah, like the scales were lifted from her eyes and she'd be able to see exactly, you know, that she was kind of spellbound by...
which technically came true, whether or not she was put under any sort of spell, but she had the moment that Stannis stood firm against where... she collapsed and said, no, we can't do this.
Mm.
And Stannis let it happen.
I think there could be some retribution in terms of magical significance here about what Stannis has done.
There has to be. There has to be something.
If you think
or
about
nothing.
Just in the TV show, the impact of the magic already. So just the magic from the
leeches
with Gendry's blood. Now, he is a bastard of Stannis' brother. And if you just think about the strength, I suppose, of the bloodlines and the king's blood, then Gendry's kind of a bit far removed from Shireen. Shireen's a much more direct
king's
blood connection, I think.
Goes to our last review that we did, and I explained what I think about king's blood, and I don't think it plays that way. Blood is blood.
Maybe some blood is more magical than others. I don't know. I would imagine that if a small prick of Gendry's blood has the effect of maybe being able to eliminate three kings, then what will Shireen, what will Shireen's King's Blood do? Will it do anything, if nothing? If it doesn't, what will Stannis do to Mel?
This is notes that I have, and I'm pretty much going to just read them verbatim. Mm-hmm. And I did not realize she was going to ask this, but I was going to bring it up. But last season on the Small Council, both Charlie and myself commented that the only thing we truly know about Shireen, about Mel for certain, is that she can see things in the flames. If she saw the deaths of Joffrey, Renly, and Balon, she can say, we need to make a sacrifice and this is going to happen. And when that sacrifice isn't permitted to her, she can it still happens. And she seems like this powerful woman.
I wouldn't put anything past that fucking bitch.
The sacrifice of Shireen seems to aid the belief in that she knew they would die anyways, and therefore a great sacrifice was needed to depose three kings. Or therefore not a great sacrifice was needed to depose three kings. Arguably there are three false kings, but three kings nonetheless. Therefore, why is it such a sacrifice needed to take Winterfell / the North? What is the result? Now that, with this actual sacrifice being made, there's only two ways that I can see this playing out. Some great magic happens. I don't think it's going to be Shadow Baby or anything like that. Or absolutely nothing happens, and Melisandre is proved wrong, and there's fucking Stannis has made the worst decision he's ever made.
Something has got to happen because they've got to march forward to Winterfell, so they must have to get out of that situation.
Why do they have to march forward to Winterfell?
Well, they've got to march somewhere, otherwise they're going to die where they are. The food lines have been cut. Most of the men have deserted. The ones that are there are kind of shunning away from Stannis already.
But in the books, they're waiting for the battle to come to them. Or they're at least still camp.
Yeah.
So what do you mean they have to march forward? They can wait and have forward come to them.
Well, they already have. And Ramsay and just 20 good men, apparently, have already...
battle. They've just ruined.
They're stuck in an impasse at the moment with lack of food in the cold. It's been drilled into us as show watchers that they're in a bit of an impossible situation.
And I mean, I agree with you that something has
will to this make any difference at all? I think it has to, otherwise they just all die there.
Or they retreat, and nothing came of it. And then we go to the wall, and we have perhaps. John, anything Azor Ahai related happening back there?
I don't think Stannis will do that. He's already said there will be.
You're right, and I do agree with you.
They're moving forward, and that's it.
I'm still looking for quote unquote some sort of Mexican standoff between Stannis, Brienne, and Roose and Ramsay and Sansa, where Brienne has to stand there and decide whether or not she kills Stannis, because. Stannis killed Renly, or...
Well, now I kind of hope she does. I was a bit conflicted before.
Or she keeps her oath and tries to help, joins with Stannis and attacks Ramsay. I'm hoping for a Mexican standoff, but, I mean...
In terms of what happens next after this scene, and I don't think we will probably be revisiting any of it at all next episode... I think next episode is Mother's Mercy, and it's going to be Arya, it's going to be... Well, there was a synopsis somewhere that said, I can't remember, something like John is... it was actually in the magazine that I was reading before, the TV magazine. In fact, let me find it. Because it had a synopsis on it. On what happens next, but what do you, in terms of Stannis, what do you think is going to be happening with Davos?
Well, I mean, we touched on it a little bit there. I think.
Do you think he'll abandon Stannis when he finds out?
I don't know. This is such a hard place to think. Previously, I would say no, Davos isn't going to abandon Stannis ever.
Yeah.
This. I think, and you just mentioned the don't come back empty-handed.
Mm.
He's either going to come back empty-handed and not be Stannis' hand, or perhaps something else that you said in our 7 and 8 reviews is that you thought Sansa is sort of melding into the Manderly role.
Yeah.
Of knowing where Bran and Rickon are alive.
Mm-hmm.
And she's going to send somebody to look for him, so maybe Stannis or Davos works with her.
Right, here's the official plot description for episode 10 for the finale. Stannis marches, Daenerys is surrounded by strangers, plus Cersei seeks forgiveness and Jon is challenged.
Why would you say he didn't? No, obviously they're much forward then.
Yeah, I didn't say I didn't know. I said, do you think it'll make any difference whatsoever? It might make a small difference, which means that they can move forward. But I just think this is Shireen. This is your direct, it's your heir, it's your direct descendant. It's not some random bastard that you've picked up somewhere along the way.
So there's
what impact is it going to have? That doesn't tell us a great deal, really. I think he's got to get to Winterfell.
Stannis marches. Okay, Stannis marches. Either this hasn't worked, nothing's happened, and he says, fuck it, I've made the worst decision of my life. My life is shit now.
Mm.
I'm going to go do this, and whatever happens, happens. And he marches, or something climactic does happen because of it, and he marches. I mean, that doesn't say much.
But again, March is where we presume it's Winterfell.
We presume, yes.
I don't think we're going to get any kind of battle of ice or the battle.
There's
of
nobody
Winterfell.
There at Winterfell to do the battle of ice, which is the shitty thing.
I don't know. I'm not entirely sure what's going to happen. Now, I don't know if there will be any of this storyline into the next episode.
In regards to the pink letter, Stannis has actually done what the pink letter has done by sending Davos to the wall to bring back the men. Now, Claire and I are both, again, in agreement with Tony Teflon that Stannis wrote the pink letter.
In the books.
And the pink letter's purpose was to get Jon to move south towards Winterfell so that he could join up with Stannis and then, you know, have a bit of an army there, supplies and everything like that. He sent Davos there in his stead, so that's sort of a hint towards the pink letter, possibly. But what happens now? Does Davos come back with what's? I guess Davos arrives. So this is what happens.
This is what happens.
Davos arrives.
Yeah.
Tells John everything about Ramsay and whatever, about what's happened. And John does his moment and then packs up and heads for Winterfell, and he gets his up and comings. I don't think that was the right word.
Comeuppance.
That's what I was looking for. So that's probably how that's going to play out. Right? Davos arrives.
Yeah.
John says, yes, okay, let's get them the fuck out of there and come. So that would be the pink letter.
Okay.
Correct.
Right. And then maybe that's what the men at the wall say, that's the last straw.
That's exactly what's going to happen.
Yeah. I don't know. I can't see how Davos will continue to be loyal to Stannis. I think how could it be? Davos loved Shireen.
Yeah, so did Stannis.
Yeah, he did. And actually, it makes me think, was Stannis just, and again, this is probably just my justification, and Adrienne, if you're listening, this is for me and you, Chick, so this is me trying to provide some kind of justification for what might have happened in this traumatic scene.
What did Adrian say?
I'm just presuming that she's going to be as distraught about this as I am, because she was distraught about as much as I was about Sansa. So the question, I suppose, is, do we think that Stannis is, because he was at the very beginning, he talks to Davos about what's happened with the attack, Ramsay and his 20 good men. And there's this kind of, well, what we're going to do, how we, what we're going to do next. And Stannis turns around and he looks and he sees Salis and Mel outside the tent. They go into the tent and they obviously talk about something. Does she show him something? Does she, what does she do to convince him? How, what was it that, that happened in that tent? Did something happen, some kind of magical thing that somehow, basically what I'm asking is it possible that Stannis is bewitched by Mel beyond his control? At the very end, when this has all happened and you can hear Shireen's screams, the closing shot of that scene is Stannis turning round, just looking like some kind of conflicted zombie at the very end of it.
I took that sort of both ways, but I took it as he's either suffering pangs of regret at, you know, what just happened, his daughter's gone, or perhaps some sort of transformation happening. I tend to go with the first, but I'm not sure. Anyways.
I just think the question for me is, sorry, will this trigger something that...
magical.
Magical, mm-hmm. that is not necessarily what they expect to happen. So could this be, could this trigger something else that we're not aware
like
of?
What?
Like ice magic.
What's ice magic?
Well, we don't know what ice magic is.
Why would
we know
fire magic trigger ice magic?
Because they're in the north.
What are you thinking? You told me what
I
you were thinking.
I just want some kind of reason and justification for why this has happened.
Well, you said, you mentioned ice dragon to me.
Yeah, I don't know why, though. I can't remember.
I mean, obviously, Azor Ahai. So I don't know what what sort of magic crops are going
to
grow.
I'm pissed off with it, and I'm trying to think of a reason and a justification for... It can't just be that he's burned his daughter and that's it. And nothing
or that
happens,
could be
or something
the exact
small significance
point
happens.
Of he believed in... Okay. So this is my intro to this, talking about this. So we've had a lot of religious imagery in the last few episodes, and I'm reading this off the paper. We've had the
yes.
Knights King's Jesus Christ pose,
yeah.
We've had the Four Horsemen. You pointed that out to me. I didn't pick up on the Four Horsemen, although I hadn't looked. Add that in there. And I will add to that that there's a visual of the raising of the dead, which is sort of reminiscent of the second coming of Christ. So you have the Jesus Christ pose and then the raising of the dead.
Yeah.
Religion in general has been apparent this season more than most. Now, we've discussed this in our 7 and 8 review, but I'm going to bring it up again here. Yeah, I wrote this all down. And in regards to Stannis and whether he is a religious person or rather he's faithful or a believer, at least in what Mel is telling him. You want to go just plug that in?
Mm-hmm.
Something's not right. Barda Porto touched on this a bit in her review as well. And as always, I'll try to have everyone's links that we mention here in the description below. There are a lot of religious people in the world that we live in, you and I, whether they adhere to one religion or another without wavering. My point here being that if you truly believe in your God, and you truly believe your God had a purpose for you, and required a sacrifice for perhaps just to prove that you're loyal to your God. Like, put it in terms of heaven. If you believe in Jesus Christ and God and Christianity, and for some unknown reason, you fully, truly believe that God is talking to you, but to prove your loyalty to God, he asks you to sacrifice one of your kids. Do you do it?
Well, then you asked me this question the other day, and I said, my response would be, not that I'm a religious person, but my response would be, then you're not worthy of my loyalty if that's what you're asking of me.
Yeah, but, okay, put it in terms of heaven, though. If you believe that you're going up to heaven, and your child's going to be there waiting for you, and everything's going to be perfect, but to save the rest of the world, and this is granted, you have to believe in heaven. You have to be a true believer. Would you do the sacrifice for your God who you've devoted your life to? And you
know
swear
what?
That
you know
live
what,
by
Andy,
his
maybe
law.
Some people would. Maybe some people would, in the story and also in real life, devout fanatics who believe that this is the only way. And we know there are certain cultures where young women are set on fire by family members for kind of breaking honour codes and things like that. We know that this happens, and there's cruelty and horrible things that people do to their own family members. In this particular case, I just never thought that Stannis would have been capable of that. And I think, given the last episode when he said to Mel, is there no other way? The leeches, you know, is there anything? And I just think that wasn't explored far enough at all. Why does she need...
But there's no other way. They're not at the wall. They're right there. There's no other way. That's the king's blood that she needs. Or himself. In my opinion, Stannis should have said, if I'm supposed to be fucking the second coming of Azor Ahai, burn me.
And I'll
take
come back.
My blood and I'll come back. Yeah,
yeah,
that's what he should have done.
Yes, I agree.
But in this question that I'm asking, and if you're a true believer, which you yourself are not, I myself am not, if you devote your life to a religion and your God, and you believe, fully believe, that you've had some sort of divine approach by God, and you're talking to God, and he says, sacrifice your child for me, you will see your child again in heaven.
Well, I'll tell you what the answer is. Selyse. The answer to that question is look at Selyse. She was the most devout. She was the most blinded by R'hllor and the Red God. She's been saying all sorts of horrible, threatening things about Shireen. I'm really worried about the safety of Shireen all the
but
way through this
not
because
a true
of Selyse. She was the one at the very end who said, no, this is wrong.
Which is fine. That is fine. And I agree with that. It is wrong. It's absolutely wrong. But if you believe in heaven, and I'm using Christianity and heaven as a device here, and you're going to be reunited with your child up there, but to save the rest of humanity because God wants you to, you have to sacrifice. To prove that you're worthy to God, sacrifice your child, and God will hold your daughter in trust until you rise up to join her. Would you not do it if you're a true believer, and that once you die from this place, you will be resurrected?
Personally, I can't answer that question
with your child.
A, I haven't got children, and B, I'm not a true believer. So I find that an extremely difficult question to answer.
And I agree, it is.
Should we move on before we fall out?
No. Fall out whenever the hell you want. Anyways. Blah, 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 blah. Now, I'm not trying to defend what Stannis did here, and one of our viewers named Eric Elgrinch has mentioned to me in a few quotes today where Stannis doesn't appear to be a true believer. And my own personal opinion of Stannis is that he's always been a man of ambition, and he hides it behind it's mine by rights.
Yeah, I questioned that, didn't I? I said to you, I don't think he is ambition. I think he just feels the burden of responsibility.
And to me, that's ridiculous. If you don't want to be fucking king, you don't become king. You don't have to be king.
Yeah.
We have it in the books. There's people that were in line to be king.
So maybe there is a vanity there with Stannis. Yeah. Maybe there's always been a hidden vanity there.
So he's always been acting out of ambition rather than entitlement. I do believe following the sacrifice of Shireen, we will have to see some form of consequence in regards to whether the sacrifice worked, or conversely, that Stannis made the worst decision in his life for absolutely no reason. And again, this could also be a way for D&D to show us that Stannis will not become Azor Ahai, or in fact that Mel's right from the beginning and he is Azor Ahai. Maybe when she looks for a glimpse of Azor Ahai and all she sees is snow, that's because IMO John is perhaps the enemy of Azor Ahai. Or vice versa. Mm-hmm. And that can go both ways. I have a lot of thoughts on Stannis as Night's King as well. Or taking over the position of Night's King at some point. Mm-hmm. That is my rant on Stannis and Faith and whether or not he had some sort of cause to do this. Just for a belief. I don't agree with it. I don't think that he made the right choice. And another theme throughout this episode is the rock and the hard place, where sacrifices must be made by other people, but they're different forms. They take on different actions to get their intended result, or results are presented to them just naturally, organically. Stannis maybe didn't have that option. Continue. Where are we going to now? Sorry.
Well done. I think you're getting, the points that you're making are, they're interesting and can justify to an extent how this might have happened.
It's nothing that I can personally agree with. I'm just trying to look for, and at the middle of my notes, and we just watched James Johnson just put out a 5-minute video right before we started doing this, and we watched it. And I think he touches similarly on maybe nothing like what I just said, but the fact of honor and duty. And if you believe in your duty, what do you do to, how does your honor and duty go hand in hand?
Makes me laugh how you say duty.
I know what you're trying to do.
Duty.
Duty.
Oh, God. Bitch. Right. All I would say in conclusion to this, and really, please let's move on, is yes. I just hope it works. Well, I know it has to work out differently in the books, because Shireen's not with Stannis in the books at this stage. So if she burns, I don't think it will be Stannis' responsibility or fault that happens. Even if it does, they would, I think you said this again, to me, there would have to be a Stannis point of view chapter that explains
why. If Shireen ever does burn and Stannis permits it, we have to get a Stannis actual POV where we get inside of his head, not just what he tells other people and what their interpretations of what he's saying is. We have to get inside his head. Eric Elgrinch, again, I believe it was him today, has given me other arguments where Stannis has talked about the sacrifice. And so it looks like it's very possible that Stannis will be.
He's been thinking this all along.
Not that he's thinking, but that he's going to be amiable to it. He's going to do it.
Yeah, but he's also said, if you hear, and I'm dead, sit my daughter on the throne.
Yeah, he has, but that's before he was told he had to sacrifice her to get what he wants.
I feel like burning these notes on Stannis.
I'll just fold them up for now. We do have to this isn't a very new argument. I do remember James and Donna talking about this, and I think to Tony, about Stannis actually redeeming himself and saving Shireen and saying, no, we will not, which this episode gives us him not doing it. Is there a chance for him to do it in the book still? Absolutely. Will Shireen burn in the books? I'm going to say absolutely, but I don't think that's the last we're going to see of Shireen.
Okay.
There has to be something to do with the grayscale.
There has to be. Mm-hmm. Let's move on.
Okay.
We've got a few more places to visit. We've got, let's look at the wall next.
Okay,
so we have John arriving with the wildlings, and there's a kind of standoff with Alyssa Thorne on the top of the wall. I did notice that when there was that standoff, 1-1 was at the front, and if you look at him, he kind of has his head down like this, as though he knows he's being judged and he's kind of on his best behaviour. And I just thought, oh, he's so sweet. I mean, isn't he like when he gets to the wall in the books, he's isn't he like a vegetarian and he doesn't drink alcohol?
Win-win is the shit, that's all I'm going to say.
The shit?
Yep.
Yes, you were really excited when we saw 1-1 in episode 8.
Which she mentions in our other review as
well.
And compares him to hockey, which is ridiculous.
When you saw him, you cheered as loudly as if your hockey team had scored.
You mean my hockey team?
Hockey.
What's my hockey team?
The Go Flames Go.
Thank you.
Okay. Right. We get Alyssa Thorne on the other side when they decided to let him through, open the gates. And he says to John, you have a good heart, Jon Snow. It'll get us all killed. And again, just very touching very slightly on Stannis, I just thought that kind of juxtaposed the situation with Stannis, where so Alyssa Thorne says, you have a good heart, Jon Snow, it'll get us killed. And it just made me think, you've got a black heart, Stannis, but everyone in the camp is still alive, still lives, which is a twisted way, I suppose, of looking at it. But that's what it, when I went back and we rewatched the episode and I caught that quote from Thorne, it just made me think of Stannis again. You also get the kind of obligatory grumpy look from Ollie, you know, the Ollie face.
Yes. Claire does have a mean Ollie face.
Which is this. This is Ollie face. And just in case you weren't sure of it, the camera pans back again, yes, in episode 82.
Earlier episodes, yes. It's like beating Ollie face into us.
Which makes me think it's so obvious. Maybe it won't be Ollie and maybe it'll be a surprise or a shock or whatever. I don't know. I'm not sure.
It's a very good point. We are so set on Ollie doing this now that we're all watching for it.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody else has to do it. Mm-hmm. They're just beating it into our heads so damn much, this Ollie thing, that I don't know. I don't know. I was fully aboard with Ollie doing it, but now, because of that last episode, when you just see his face and see his face and see his face. I don't know.
That's all I've got really for the wall. Is there anything else that you wanted to say?
The wall and Hardhome. And I mentioned these two. What you have here with John looking up at Alistair is the reverse of the Night's King looking down at John. This is John himself stuck between his own rock and hard place. Same position Stannis is in, except the Night's Watch actually opened the gate and let them through, whereas in the last episode, you get everybody shut out. We have arguments that we made in our last episode comparing that closing of the gate and locking everybody out to the actual wall itself going up. My point regarding that, and we will try to release our 7 and 8 reviews at least in some fashion, but is the wildlings think that the wall was put up to keep them out, or it's mentioned on occasion, which is ridiculous given what we at least think we know about the erection of the wall, which is it happens through many years. Why the fuck would you stay on the other side when you see this wall getting built up? Why wouldn't you move south? So it's a very strange concept. Whereas the gate gets closed fast and you get locked out. To me, that has magical implications. The magic was there before the wall. The wall's put up around the magic, is my opinion.
You said erection.
I know, and I was hoping that would just slide by.
I can't let things like that slide by.
And I'm the immature one.
I'm just trying to cheer myself up after Stannis. But yes, very good point though about the wall, the you know, the, I mean, we did talk about this in the last episode.
And what I'm saying here was the gate being closed and Alistair Thorne being the juxtaposition of the last scene that we, the Hardhome scene with Jon looking up at him, is the gate being opened and the wildlings actually get let through. This is the Night's Watch sacrifice. Because of Jon, they're sacrificing and letting through their quote-unquote enemy through the gates, something that's never happened before. They've made their sacrifice, and what's to happen about that? Alistair Thorne says, you're going to get us all killed. Mm-hmm. So who knows? That's, I think, all my points that I have on that.
Wow, that was quite quick. Let's move to Dawn.
The sword?
Dawn.
The sword.
What are you talking about?
What are you saying?
Dawn.
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 Dorn.
D-O-R-N. That's how you pronounce it. Dawn.
Dawn.
Dawn as in like the break of day.
Well, that's what you're saying.
There's... No. I think we just pronounce it differently. Dawn. And dawn. Dawn.
What?
And dawn. You're saying dawn, like Don the Crack and Wit.
Yeah, dawn or dawn. Yeah, what are you saying?
Dawn or dawn. There's an R in it. Dawn. Anyway, you know, that bit of the south of Westeros.
Dawn.
There, just there, Sunspear and everything, just over there.
All right, I was just fucking with her about that. I know what you were saying.
We've been having lots of fun with accents. Okay. I haven't really got much from this. I haven't had a great deal of fun with Dawn, really, this year, this season. Well, we haven't seen it before, and I think they've buggered it up from the start. But I thought it was interesting that we find out that Tristane's going to be on the Small Council.
Absolutely.
Which makes me think, does Tristane know what Doran's real plans are?
Yes, he does.
Does he?
Yes. Tristane knows. The others don't. Tristane does.
I think Doran's trusted Tristane.
Yes.
Even though he's got this teenage Disney thing going on with Marcella.
Well, he might be acting.
Could be. He could be. Yeah.
This. Okay, so I know you know what I'm about to lead into here. Do you want me to get into that,
yeah,
or you
on.
Have nothing to say?
Yeah.
Okay. So, and I agree. And I'm actually curious as to perhaps the Dawn scenes are so awful this season. And there's a reason for that. But I digress. We'll concentrate on what's happened in this episode. And what I think we're having in this scene, at least the meeting with Jaime and Doran, is a weird mirroring of the White Harbor, the Farce at White Harbor chapter in Dance with Dragons, Davos 3, I believe it is, in which...
The Manderlys.
The Manderlys. There's a farce that happens when he sort of presents them a scenario that people aren't exactly aware that they're involved in, but they all have their little parts to play and they don't know they're playing it.
Hmm.
With Ilaria, he absolutely knows what Ilaria's response is going to be.
Hmm.
He knows she's going to be pissed off. He's expecting that. So my notes here are that I found this scene eerily similar to the farce at White Harbor. What I took from it was Doran lying to Jaime by showing him the truth and how much Doran doesn't trust the Lannisters. And in doing so, he is using the honest reactions of Ilaria and Marcella, where I assume Tristain is privy to Doran's plans.
Mm.
So he lets Jaime know he isn't trusted, but he acquiesces by giving Jaime Tristain. Giving Jaime the power by sending Tristain to King's Landing. This is, we talked about in our 7 and 8 review, another possible Trojan horse. The gift, I had some scenarios that I thought were perhaps Trojan horses, a gift Trojan horse that way, which we talked about. And the farce of White Harbor chapter was similar to this in that extent. And I asked you to help me elaborate on this because you have a much better memory of instances of the White Harbor chapter and probably everything that happened in this episode.
I think it's interesting that he uses what he knows the reactions are going to be to make his point, to cover up what his real point is.
Is it your honest opinion that you think that he knows Alara is going to be pissed off?
Oh, absolutely.
He expected that reaction from her.
Yeah.
So he's using this, we don't like you, and I'm showing you that we don't like you, but we're giving you all the power, and yet really, they're not.
I mean, even with, you know the scene where he says, swear allegiance or die, and she bends down and kisses his hand, and she cries.
Which I believe is Stannis and R'hllor.
Well, you can kind of see the expression on Doran's face. Is this going to be the time where he kind of reveals to her what's...
The next scene is she's all happy with Jaime. So I think he either did it right before then, he told her the truth and said, and now she knows his plan, or he's done it afterwards. But when she goes and talks to Jaime and tries to break bread with him and have common ground regarding Cersei and the incest versus bastards and whatnot with Oberyn, it's very, she's making her effort there. So there's something.
What is Doran's true motive in the TV show? Because it's got to be different from the books. The books is, there's a pact that goes back years and years with the Dornish and the Targaryens.
Mm-hmm.
Quentin, basically, for anyone who's not a book reader, Doran has three children, not just Tristain. In the books, he has Tristain as the youngest son. He's got another son. He's got another son called Quentin, and the eldest sibling, which illustrates the kind of gender primogeniture from Dawn, from the Dawnish point of view. I'm just trying to think of the name. And the pact is that Arianne, as the eldest sibling, was meant to marry Viserys Targaryen. He obviously died, so the new plan was for Quentin to marry Daenerys. So what could this plan be for the TV, Doran? Or isn't there any? Because if there isn't, then that just kind of adds another layer of like
extreme speculation of what's happening with Tristain in King's Landing. You can have perhaps, again, I think this is a Trojan horse of some manner, but you can have You're welcome. Him plotting to have King's Landing working from the inside out. Embrace Dany when she finally crosses, perhaps. If he knows about her. We don't even know that they know about Dany. So, I mean, I'm not sure. It's very, very speculative at that point. Maybe it's just Trystane and Marcella on the Iron Throne, like King and Queen.
So Trystane and Marcella maybe is to forge this fake alliance between the Martells and the Lannisters as a holding pattern to get Tristan into King's Landing for when Daenerys arrives and he proves to be the,
but again, we
the,
don't know
the perfect
that,
suitor.
We don't even know that they're even aware of Dany at this point,
yeah,
I don't think. So it could just be maybe Tommen's on his way out and that's Doran's master plan. Maybe they're going to assassinate Tommen somehow and have Trystane and Marcella on the throne. I don't know.
Anything else that we can say about... Oh, the in the cells,
The slap game. I loved it. I absolutely loved it. To me, the slap game, which we also have the very first fights in the Colosseum with the strong guy versus the quick guy. It's the exact same thing. This is just, again... George's points throughout the books. It's the Vanguard. It's Jaime getting captured. It's Tyrion's assumption when Catelyn pulls the wool over his eyes. It's Cyril's tale about the Sea Lord's cat. They're just warnings about jumping to conclusions, acting too quickly. The quick doesn't always win. I champion this because I'm a slow thinker. I'm very slow. People that have watched my three videos I put out for the year before this year would understand that I take my time. So I love this. I do. I love it because you have to get lost in it. You can't just boom, 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 boom. My opinion only. There are people that are very fast and do very, very good work. But I can't, and I pick my spots, and that's all I can do. And that's what she does there, is lulls her into this false sense of anything and just this fucking boom. Oh, yes. I love it. It was great. It was probably my favorite of the Dorne scene. Sorry, go ahead.
Another book reader reference, going back to Shireen, when Davos says, "Oh, I'm looking forward to finding out about the rest of that story about Dance with Dragons," and he says something like, "You can tell me about it when I get back," and thank you. And she says, "Read it yourself. You can read it yourself."
Yes, yes, yes. No, absolutely, you're correct.
Yeah.
I was concentrating on pouring rather than listening to you. I'm very
multitasking.
I'm not multitasking, not a big thing. It's probably why I'm so slow.
The next two areas to visit are probably the highlight of the episode for me. So we've got Braavos and Meereen. So let's look into Braavos first. The thing that I really like about the scenes in Braavos is I'm constantly fascinated with the scenery and the cinematography. So you can always see the Titan when they're outside. You seem to be able to see in the distance
the kind of
shadow of the Titan, which just looks amazing to me.
Concept that not even anything from the show, just random thought that I had. And you've mentioned a lot about statues and stuff like that. And I was picturing when Arya came through and she says, "It's only a statue." There's this... Something else brought it into my mind about statues, though. But they're always erected of real people.
Mm-hmm.
So Arya is saying, "Of this is only a statue." At one point, it wasn't. This is made to represent somebody, and we have statues and all sorts of things. And then there's religious statues, and
it just looks like something out of Jason and the Argonauts or something. You know, it just seems like really really fantastical, and then you can just see it in the shots in the background.
Yeah, I'm just sorry, my head's tied into things like stone men and statues. What does it all mean?
We also, it's talking about scenery, we get to see the Iron Bank.
Yes.
Which is massive.
I never went back and paid any attention to Mace, and then wanted to rewatch that scene, and I never took any notes from that.
Mace is doing his, it's when he starts singing and they're in like a square, and it's just when you actually look and see the bit, they're outside the Iron Bank, and it looks very imposing.
I understand that. I imagine there's something with Mace that I should have gone back and looked at, and I haven't. I know he said something about...
Maybe the song he was singing probably had significance.
There's a song, and he says something to him, and I don't have the quotes in it. Something about gambling, which made me think of the gambler, but that they've always made the right bets, or something like that.
Yeah.
Like this flattering sort of scenario.
Yeah, it's what it links the kind of their wealth to gambling.
But making...
Yeah.
Betting on the right horse.
The other thing that I liked about Braavos is that you get a shout to Brusco. So the brothel owner in the TV show in this episode is called Brusco. There is a Brusco in the books, but he's not a brothel owner. He's a local trader.
Should be hiring Arya right now, who she's delivering the coffee.
Yeah, Arya lives with Brusco for a while and his daughters. She goes to stay with them, and it's kind of part of a training. And she's got a different face at the time. She's a different character. But I just thought it was quite nice that there was a shout to Brusco from the books.
Absolutely, I agree. I think I even cheered at that point too. Hey, Brusco.
Yeah. Do you think that Trant recognised Arya?
It's very hard for me to say. He's definitely, there's recognition, whether or not he's placed her, I don't know.
It would have been a number of years ago, but certainly he would have got a good look at her during this fight scene with Syrio.
Now, these are two aspects of it. Trant, obviously a pedophile. With Arya in King's Landing back then, he could have actually focused in on her at that point. And been, you know, having these, like, just leering looks at her all throughout her time there that we don't know about, we've never known about. But I was, up until just now, uncertain that he actually recognized her. I thought maybe she would have walked back and forth sort of unnoticed, because that's who Arya was. She was like this many-changing...
He seems to be working out. He's on the verge of working out whether or not he knows her. He's kind of, he's got this kind of quizzical look on his face, and just at the moment when
she gets dragged off,
just at the moment when you think, oh shit, he's going to recognise exactly who she is. He gets distracted by the young girl the Shieldu, the one that's like really young, and he just kind of is looking and he's kind of trying to figure something out, and then he gets distracted by
I didn't see him getting distracted by her. I thought Arya got shoved out that girl.
No, it sort of all happens at the same time, but it's almost like he's on the verge of recognizing her.
The one thing that I loved about the Trant scene, which is hard to say that you love anything about Trant scene. But his fucking hypocrisy when he calls Renly the boy fucker. And then we come in a few minutes later and we realize what Meryn Trant is, which is I thought that was a brilliant point to show that people who do awful things generally accuse other people of doing awful things.
Well, he spent a lot of time around the Lannisters and Joffrey and Cersei, so you know that a presumption of
gotcha. I see
is different
saying.
For me.
Yeah.
You might be scum of the earth,
but I'm not, even though I have do all these horrendous things, but I'm me.
It's like that non-acknowledgement of like, oh, it's but it's different for me. There are different rules. Yeah, and again, he's been around those kind of people. I think if he does recognize Arya, or if he's on the verge of, or Arya suspects that he might, because she certainly seemed to be like, oh God, he might recognize me. And she's kind of hiding from him, but spying at the same time. But if she does think that he's going to recognise her, or if he does indeed recognise her, then if this thing, you know, of like, will you fight, will you make sure there's a fresh virgin, for underage virgin for me tomorrow? That's Arya's way in there. She's got the poison. She said to Jaqen tomorrow.
My head just went to a really dirty place right now. It's awful. I'm just sorry, and I apologize for this, really, because what we're talking about right now, but just going off the show. Fresh clams and cockles, and that's her. So she's...
Yeah.
You get that fresh clam thing. And have something fresh.
How much for your little clam?
Yeah, and then... Will you have a fresh one for me tomorrow? Obviously, we knew it was going to be, well, we thought it was going to be Arya. I'm just putting the lead up to that through my head right now, and it's kind of really
what
dirty.
I'm saying is she's probably going to have a new face when she goes back there if she's going to pretend to be the underage virgin that he's expecting to see the day after. She's going to have a new face, and my question is, will the faceless men give her a new face, or will she have to steal one?
Very good point, and we actually talked about this beforehand, but and I think I agreed with you, but right now I'm thinking, no, she's going to, the recognition, I know we had it last season with Polliver, I guess it was, but was the Rast scene, is it Rast that Mercy kills?
No, it's Raph the Sweet.
Raph, okay.
Yeah.
Name confusion. I think we're still going to have to get his recognition. Whether or not us seeing it sort of now, this episode, means something. I mean, I would love to see them give her a new face, or you have this new actress play Arya, which would be kind of neat to see if they could take on the mannerisms and stuff that she does so well. But I think we're going to have...
I hope she fucking destroys him because it was Trant who used to beat Sansa up on Joffrey's command.
Oh, on Joffrey's command, absolutely.
So I hope that he gets it back tenfold from
Arya. He's a dead man.
Yeah.
That's going to be great to see.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah. And of course, we know it's Mother's Mercy, and Mercy's been referenced throughout this season. And the release chapter from Winds of Winter is Mercy, which is pretty much kind of corresponds with what's happening with Arya at the moment in Braavos. I think she might steal a face. I don't think she will. When she went back and told Jaqen the story, and I think quite clearly he knows that she's lying, he's not saying anything. He just said, a girl has work to do.
Was it you, or did I read someplace that you read somewhere that, like, was it you that told me, or did I read someplace that somebody else had said that maybe they thought that they would make her blind as a punishment?
Yeah, somebody, I can't remember who it was, but somebody was saying that.
That would be pretty cool.
That would be punishment is to, I think it might have been Charlie in Westeros.
Okay.
He did some predictions on his
review video, and
he thought that would be probably the appropriate punishment, that the route that they're going to go down is to make her blind, which would be, that for TV watchers only, that would be quite a shock of way to end Arya's storyline in this season.
I would like that to be punishment. I think she's going to make the kill with her own face, and that would be super cool if they blind her afterwards as punishment.
I think, though, if she has to be faceless and she has to go in disguise, just, this might be a tenuous link, but at the very end when Jaqen H'ghar / kindly Jaqen says to her, a girl has work to do, and she walks off.
This is a very good point.
what the work that she has to do is, there's actually somebody who's just been given the gift
of mercy, yeah,
and he's on the floor, and the work to do is, you go and clean this body up. Well, now we know that she's been down to the lower,
and she has access floors to
the area where the faces are, where they're stored. So she's basically got a dead body to prepare. She's got access to, so she's got work to do. She's got, maybe he was even encouraging her to do that in a subtle way. You don't know. She could find herself in this room again, and she could just whip a face and use that. But then again, we don't know if she knows how they're applied or anything like that. So maybe that won't happen. But I just thought, well, does he know that she's lying? And also, does he care? Does he care about what's happening here? Or is it the many-faced God must have his due and that's it?
Well, in the last episode, he says it's all the same to the many-faced God. But that's slightly different. That's giving and taking, whether she's taking
and that's a life on her own. A specific target.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the many-faced God must have his due, but actually, yeah, so he's owed the
lives,
Thin Man,
if she takes
not
two
Mary
lives,
Trant.
Yeah,
yes.
If she takes two lives next episode, has she shifted the fucking time-space continuum?
Yes. Well, this is what the original Jacken said, wasn't it? You know, you must pay for three lives, must pay for three lives. But yeah, I think we're going to get this next episode. It's going to be, did it say in My Little TV Guide anything about Arya?
Weird British tabloid magazines, by the way.
Heat Magazine, in case any British viewers here. Yeah, Heat Magazine. No, we've just got Stannis, Daenerys and Cersei and Jon mentioned here. Nothing about Arya, but I just think it's going to be obvious if the title's Mother's Mercy. We're going to see it. And that's going to be, the viewers are going to need to have some kind of satisfying end to this season, given what happened in this episode.
Trant's dead, so we have mercy in the title, so we're getting mercy.
Yeah.
Absolutely, which actually I think in our 7 and 8 review, I thought maybe we wouldn't until next season. I thought maybe we would see them pulling up episode 10 and it would be a carryover because mercy is a WoW chapter rather than a Dance with Dragons chapter, but apparently I'm wrong there. What else?
That's all I've got for Bravo.
This is a long review for us.
I know.
I'm going crazy. I think we're doing good, though.
Yeah. Bravo's done. We can move to Marine.
All right.
Yeah. Like I said previously, I feel as though I kind of was a bit fuzzy and missed the first few minutes of this scene because I was just so completely, just couldn't compose myself after what had happened with Stannis and Shireen. God. One of the things that we had a huge discussion on was the fight scene, was the competitors pit against each other in the great games.
And essentially, the reason we focused on this so much was, first, we noticed the Dothraki.
Mm.
And then I went and made the point of, is he going to die first? And he did, and that triggered something in us. Okay, so what's this mean? Because obviously Khal Drogo dies first.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have... Do you have it written down?
Yeah, I've got them. We went back and examined. There are six fighters.
Mm-hmm.
And you have Jorah versus what looks like, the black guy looks like he's dressed very similar to Erohotar in Dawn, who's the kind of manservant of Doran.
Mm-hmm.
Over at Sunspear in the Water Gardens with the guy with the axe. So he's probably from Norvos.
But the axes are the same too, correct?
Yes.
We're assuming he's
so you've got Jorah versus the guy from Norvos, who Jorah knocks out. Then you've got the Dothraki being beaten by It took me a while to recognize this, but it's you got it immediately. The water dancer, the Bravosi.
Yeah, it's a Bravosi, absolutely.
With the short fin spear. So the Bravosi knocks out the Dothraki, and then you've got the Myrinese champion who's fighting what looks like a kind of savage, or I was saying maybe a lamb man.
It's like a barbarian type character, and we don't know where you fit that person. So I'm not entirely sure. Scheme of things.
But who you have at the end of it is Jorah fighting the Bravosi, who almost
kills
him. And then in the end, the champion kills the Bravosi.
The Myrinese champion kills the Bravosi, and then him and Jorah fight, and Jorah kills.
I think there's some significance to this, and we've gone backwards and forwards about does this signify men in phases of
Dany's life?
Yeah. Does it signify geographical areas that she's travelled through and left?
Or where she's going to travel to?
It was just interesting that the Dothraki went down first.
Yeah.
Then you have the last two men standing are Jorah, the Westerosi knight, and the Myrinese champion. So Dothraki goes, the Myrinese champion goes, and at the end it's Jorah. So does that mean she's finished with the Dothraki?
Everything there.
In terms of her allegiance to them, or, you know, yes, she's still Khaleesi, but her focus isn't with the Dothraki anymore. Equally, she seems to be going off the boil a little bit with Meereen. She said, I can burn your city to the ground, quite casually, to Histar. But you, at the end of the day, you've got Jorah left standing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that means something, the significance of who he fights
the Westerosi Knight.
Yeah.
In his announcement, too. What it all means, we really don't know, but we think there's something there. Maybe greater minds can figure it out.
Yeah.
I went to loves of Dany's life with, or maybe not even loves, but men of interest in her life with Cal, Dario and Jorah, but then we have the Water Dancer and the Barbarian, which is a little strange.
It does make me think that's strange that there's a Water Dancer there.
If there's meaning to it, but it's possible there isn't meaning does to that it. Or maybe mean, the first and the last are just the last two.
Does that mean, though, that Arya is going to run into Dany at some point later on?
Very possible.
Anyway, we did think it was interesting, the significance of who was represented in the kind of knockout tournament with the fighters. I think the thing that, like I said earlier, the thing that kind of woke me up from my days from what had happened with Shireen was Jorah throwing the spear, and it was, you know, and we kind of paused that and rewound it to see if we could see how the hell did Jorah even see that, because he must have moved so fast.
Real world, and we're just watching
it on TV. We're not real.
Nope.
I think the other thing is there was at least two or three chants from the crowd that specifically I heard quite loudly just before his star, I think, gets stabbed, or just before it all starts kicking off. That sounds to me like Miri Mazda.
Yeah, it did. And we Miri went Mazda, back and
we rewound it, rewound it. Miri Mazda, Miri Mazda.
When she first did, she's like, somebody just say Miri Mazda.
Miri Mazda, Miri Mazda. But you said you thought it was Kill the Masters.
After you're listening to it, I thought Miri Mazda, it was
Kill the Masters. Miri Mazda,
and then
kill
right
the
afterwards,
masters.
you have one person yell this out, and then the heartbeat sort of.
Yeah, just like, shit, where have they come from? And I said, were they already there? Did they put the masks on? Did they just appear? And you can see in some of the shots, some of them are just kind of quickly putting the masks on. Okay. I'm still unclear about what the Sons of the Harpy are all about. What do they want? They seem to be killing everybody. They didn't seem to be specific targets. They just wanted, seemed to be kind of killing intermittently.
And you had mentioned that things are supposed to happen in the wedding of Danny to Hisdar.
Mm.
We don't even know if that's happened.
No, I
think... We don't know if they're wed.
No, they could be. It could have happened off screen. I don't know. It did, I mean, nobody was calling him Your Grace,
no.
I noticed. But, yeah, and then also all hell breaks loose. They're trying to, you know, protect the Queen, and they're all kind of, they all sort of band together. And very, I mean, it's almost unspoken that suddenly Jorah's back in the fold, and you've got Danny, Dario, Hisdar's gone. So obviously, for anyone who was thinking that Hisdar was anything to do with the Sons of the Harpy, clearly not, unless, again, he was a sacrificial lamb. Because there was some kind of, he disappeared somewhere, didn't he? You know, a bit of business to do before he sat down and started watching the fighting. So something weird was going on.
You've got
Daenerys, Missandei, Jorah, Tyrion. Tyrion was epic when he slit the harpy's throat to save Missandei.
Yes, both of us were like, and I told you that in my own male way. I was like, I don't want Missandei to go because she's my favorite. The women on the episode or the series at all is Missandei. She's just beautiful. And no, you got to keep Missandei around.
Yeah, for anyone, any British viewers, she used to be in Hollyoaks, which is like a tea time, teenage kind of soap opera.
I've seen...
And she played a schoolgirl, you pervert.
I've seen his star. And, yeah, way to bring it up in the pedophile episode, too, by the way. In his star in TV shows here too, and he's like this a comedian. He's plays like,
yeah, we watched a little bit the other day, Trollied, where actually the guy Mark Addy, who's Robert Baratheon, he plays the butcher in it in the supermarket.
Same thing. Yeah.
But yeah, it's a comedy, and he's actually a really good comedy
Mark
actor.
Addy being King Robert.
And then dear old Drogon turns up and saves the day.
Okay. So my point on this goes to the theme again. This is Danny at the end of this episode, once again stuck between a rock and a hard place, and how is she going to get out of this? She resigns herself to her fate, and her eyes go back, and then you hear the screech and flames and Drogon and everything like that. She has an external force as well that comes in to save her. But what she does is she sacrifices everybody else in regards to, like, she just fucking takes off, which I think is very strange, and we shouldn't take that lightly. Like, she just leaves everybody. And that's,
but again, it's a very, I mean, yeah, she was just, you would have thought she would at least take a Missandei with her, because it was like they were holding hands, and it was like, you know, well, this is it, we're going to die here, you know, I'm here with you, and then she just disappears on Drogon. But maybe it is that very special and unique Targaryen dragon bond
that
excludes everybody else.
Two points of thinking here. One is that it's her child that was dying, so she had to get her child out of there, which is the opposite of Stannis. There's another point in which Drogon himself turns and does the roar again, but doesn't light Danny up. And we saw a meme about this on the internet, but even dragons know you're not supposed to burn your family, which is quite humorous as well. But I think that's honestly sort of the point that was made there. He looks at her and says, nope, not gonna do it. So sorry, Stannis, you kind of really fucked up.
Thank you.
Oh, I agree that he fucked up. I'm just trying to ascertain why somebody would do such a thing.
Yeah.
I agree that it was the wrong choice and shouldn't have been done. He should have listened to Davos, packed up, fucking gone back to the wall, or
Let's not go back there.
Yeah.
Okay. One of the things that you mentioned visually, the imagery of Drogon when he's flying out of the pit.
So, in my opinion, we come into this scene and we go one, I believe it's one way down, sort of, the camera's slowly moving, spiraling.
Panning around the crowd.
But yeah. When Drogon goes to run up, and this is also, this goes to the symbol that we talk often about, this reoccurring symbol that we've seen throughout the show. I've mentioned it to members of the Small Council as well, and there's stuff, if you want to know the symbol.
A circular Ouroboros.
It's the circle with the line through it. You see it, the first time you're ever going to see it is the White Walkers. It's the image at the very first scene in the series that they've left in that camp. It's also the banner for the show, like the Game of Thrones banner, is that sort of same symbol. You have it in the House of Black and White. You have that symbol.
With the death pool.
Sansa wears the symbol. And if you look at this arena as this, and my head just went here just now. I was always waiting to figure out, when can I talk about the symbol? This isn't the time, but now I feel like I have to, because I don't know what the symbol means. But he heads off straight through the middle of the arena, and then he flies up, but he spirals upwards. He has to get his momentum, and he just sort of, I think this is significant of, it's the end of Dany's downward spiral.
Okay.
She's being freed. And from...
Let's hope so.
Assuming that we know what's happening from the books, she comes to a conclusion in her head that she says that she knows what she has to do now. And I'm assuming that's correct. So Dany is now mobile again, and we will see less stasis and more action from her.
I think the what made me laugh, the closing scene with Jane, you can just see the expression on Jorah's face, and it's like, Jesus Christ, he's gone through all of those trials and tribulations and a big, like, you know, fight at the end, and he just can't get a break, can he?
But the dude...
he just disappears.
Sure, Jorah loves Dany. Absolutely. But he did his fucking job. And I think to him, he's going to be proud of that. He saved her. She's alive. I think he would willingly give up his life for her.
Oh, absolutely.
Which he did. He did by entering this. Jorah sacrificed himself just to get into this. Mm. Whether he came out of it alive or not, he was putting his life on the line for her.
Yeah.
And he did it again. And that's, I think he's happy with the outcome.
What do you think is going to happen next for Jorah? Well, basically the people who were left behind. Jorah, Tyrion, and Missandei, and Daario.
Well, you said yourself, you questioned whether or not, and I agreed with you, Jorah takes over Barristan's role. He's going to be reunited to the fold. How this plays out with Grayscale, we don't know.
Tyrion's going to be involved somehow, is it?
And Tyrion,
I'm just thinking,
really,
how are they
going
to get out
but
there?
Tyrion, I got to say, has to go see the dragons. I don't think you can keep Tyrion away from the dragons. There's dragons down there?
Yeah.
Let's go. That's going to be interesting. That's going to give us perhaps some clues to Tyrion Targ, anything of that nature. How do they react to Tyrion would be very telling, perhaps.
And that's it.
All right, well, this one's 2 hours, and we only did one episode. Apologies, people. Thank you very much for watching. We will get our episode 7 and 8, at least highlights, or we may redo it and take out some of the nonsense and blooper reel, perhaps.
That'll leave about 12 minutes of...
There was a lot. Actually, at least 2 hours of decent content.
What do you think? Yeah, probably.
We've already cut it down and we put it out there. We've just had technical difficulties with the upload. But we did put it in three segments and it's closing in on 3 hours still with the edits already into it. So,
anyway, if you are interested in seeing any of that, those discussions on episode 7 and 8, The Gift and Hard Home, let us know and we'll see if we can sort something out.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm looking forward to the finale. Have you got any predictions for the finale? Well, based on what we know that it's going to, well, it's called Mother's Mercy. We know there's going to be John. Do you think we're going to get this epic John scene next episode?
I think we have to.
Yeah,
I mean,
it's
yeah.
got to be.
Like
it?
I said, I believe here that's going to be what Davos.
Mm-hmm.
Davos talks to John. John says, "Okay, let's do it."
Mm-hmm.
And then you have the reckoning.
Cersei's
obviously, Cersei.
Yeah.
We know that's happening. It's
mm-hmm.
I again something I said in episode 7-8. I knew. Well before this episode, because it was reported like when they were filming it, so we know that that's happening.
So it looks like it's going to be focusing on Jon at the Wall, Cersei, and the Walk of Shame, because we didn't have any King's
Robert
Landing
Strong.
Actually this episode.
That's going to be cool.
Yeah.
We're going to get to see Robert Strong,
Arya, and in Braavos, and what happens with Meryn Trant. I think
mm-hmm.
that's going to be wrapped up next episode. And what was the other one they mentioned? And well, they're going to have to go back to Stannis again because apparently Stannis marches. So
marching.
I was hoping that we could just forget about all of that actually for the finale.
No, I'm excited. I want to see whether there was a righteous reason for it, something
yeah.
good happens,
mm.
or it just backfired and he is dead, like to himself, like he's done the worst.
Honestly,
thing
despite
personally.
Everything that you've said and everything that everyone's saying to me, maybe it's just because I'm still kind of just so pissed off and in shock still 2 days later, I genuinely don't think there could be any righteous reasons for why you did that. That's just me.
To me, it all depends.
At the moment,
personally,
I might change my mind, and I'm still hanging.
I'm not a believer in situations like that, but if you devote your life to something or you follow something and for some reason you believe that your God is telling you to do something,
the books are different to the TV show. That's what's going on in my head. The books are different to the TV show. Please let it be play out differently in the books.
I think it will. I absolutely think it'll play out differently in the books.
Okay.
For sure. This, to me, the sacrifice of Shireen is in a meta sort of way, was the sacrifice of Stannis via D&D.
Mm.
Stannis was the actual sacrifice
yeah.
in this episode. They just fucking tore him to shreds.
I have to say that my favorite scene in this particular episode...
And fans, too. Everybody's fucking giving up on Stannis now. And I'm not a Stannis fan. But I don't understand why loyal supporters and book readers, and I have to be looking at you, Tony, have turned your head on Stannis. And I am not a father, so I understand that aspect. But there has to be some sort of reason for him to do it. There has to be.
I don't think there ever could be, but I'm holding out hope that things are different in the books. And that's why I'm not completely abandoning
That's
Stannis,
why I am
that
too, and that's why I'm sort of arguing for Stannis' sort of redemption in the show, is because I don't think it's going to play out like this in the books, and I don't think that it's fair that everybody's given up.
If it
Stannis.
Does, I know I understand what you're saying, and I kind of agree to an extent. I think if this does play out exactly the same way in the books as D&D are alluding to, then George is going to have to do some hard work to get me back round to feeling the same way about Stannis.
Well, see, and this is where I'm different, because I've never felt this way about Stannis. To me, Stannis is ambition-hungry and hiding behind entitlement when he's clearly just ambitious. So I don't have this love for Stannis that other people do, but I don't think he's an evil person.
I wasn't grabbed by Stannis at the beginning. I thought he was miserable and, you know, he's jaw clenching and his kind of teeth grinding and stuff. In the books, he's different in the books than the TV show. I don't think he's been portrayed fairly by the showrunners throughout. That's just my
probably
personal
not.
Opinion.
To me, in that regard, if you're championing Stannis, he's not a POV character. He's never been a POV character. So you can only see him through other characters in the books. He's a little bit harder to write than our general POV characters, which is probably one of the reasons why I've never had this affinity towards Stannis that other people seem to have. I don't get inside of his
head. I'm not going to abandon Stannis entirely just yet because it's the TV show and it's not the books, and that's all I'm going
to
say.
Yeah, and I think in regards to pretty much anything that we get from the TV show, you shouldn't do anything like that. The TV show can do whatever it wants. Sure, they're building up to the same premise, but they can fucking cut people out of the show. They can make people do anything they want to do a point. Like, personally, to me, the killing of Talisa or Jane, look at that. It's nothing that we've ever seen before, but I believe that there's a reason for that. That whole stomach stabbing this scene, that's very important. Thanks for watching. We will see you in episode 10, and maybe, hopefully, somebody else will be joining us, and I really hope that they do. We'll have a party then, and the season will be over, and we can get back to some theory, some discussion, some who the fuck knows what.
Leave your comments, questions, suggestions. Let us know what you think, and we will see you next week. Bye.
I just wanted to hear you say bye.
Bye.